have the honor of introducing my friend, but also a friend to every miner in America and the most committed person that I know in this movement for the United Mine Workers is Mr. Cecil Roberts. He is a sixth-generation coal miner from Kanawha County, West Virginia. He has been the president of the United Mine Workers of America since 1995. He was reelected to his fifth full term as the international president in 2014. In fact, he is the second longest standing president of the United Mine Workers of America next to John L. Lewis. Mr. Roberts is here today on behalf of our nation coal miners, and we have them from all over the nation, and we're so proud that they are here with us today.
Chairman Hatch and Ranking Member Wyden, I want to thank you on behalf of 90,000 UMWA retirees for having this hearing, but most of all, I think I should express to everyone here that this has been a bipartisan effort on your behalf and Senator Wyden's behalf and many of the people on this committee. I'm not going to start naming names because I think I'd have to call the names of most of the people on this committee who have worked in a bipartisan way to try to save the 1974 pension plan of the United Mine Workers of America. I know many of these people we're talking about. I'm not President Roberts to most of them. I'm just Cecil when they see me. I've had an opportunity to eat dinner in their homes, and we go to rallies together, church together. So this is a very personal thing for those of us in the coal fields. As we come here today, there's 107,000 of us have been killed in this nation's coal mines trying to energize this nation so everybody else could have a decent way of life and everybody else's economy could prosper. Another 107,000 of us died choking from pneumoconiosis, and as we're in here today, there's somebody dying right this minute from pneumoconiosis or from injuries they sustained in a coal mine. The United States government has a long and history here of being involved in the 1974 pension plan. At the end of World War II, the President of the United States seized the coal industry. A lot of people don't know this part of the story. The first pension plan was not negotiated with the coal industry. It was negotiated with the United States government over at the White House. And it was the White House who said, if you coal miners will go back to work and let the nation prosper after this war, then you'll be rewarded with pensions and health care. Throughout the 70s and throughout the 90s, the government has stood up and been a part of this pension plan and promising these benefits to miners. I think the most important thing that I could say to you today, members of the committee, it's my belief that there's broad support here to fix this. I want to applaud the two senators from West Virginia for sponsoring this bill. This is a bipartisan bill, not only in the United States Senate, it's a bipartisan bill in the House of Representatives. For one time, we have bipartisanship here, and it is a struggle to try to figure out how we can't move from point A to point B when everybody says this is the solution. In 2007, the coal industry and the union negotiated a contract, and at that time, 93% of the benefits in the 74 plan were funded, and the actuary said that we were well on the way to being 100% funded, and something occurred that we couldn't control and no one in Congress can control, and that was the recession. And the people who made those decisions had nothing to do with coal miners, had nothing to do with the 74 pension plan, had nothing to do with any of the people we're talking about here today, but they had to pay the price. And I don't want to get too far out here, but we did bail those folks out, and the folks who had nothing to do with this are paying the consequences for this.
You mentioned recent increases in employer contribution rates to shore up the funding in the 1974 pension plan, with rates climbing from $2 per hour as recently as 2007 to $6.05 today. Should it become necessary, what is the prospect of further increases in that hourly contribution rate by employers, and how many employers are still contributing to the mine workers' plan?
The answer to that, Mr. Chairman, if I may, is I think additional increases in the contribution rate are out of the question. As you've just noted, they've gone up 107% since, I think, 2007 or thereabouts. What has happened is we have had one company go into bankruptcy twice and then go out of business. We had another company in Alabama that went out of business, and another company has come in their place, but they don't pay into the 74 pension plan. They would not do that. We have probably the second or third largest company in the United States, Alpha Natural Resources, that's filed for bankruptcy in the middle of that process now, and they will cease paying into the 1974 pension plan. If you take those three bankruptcies together, it's a 40-some percent reduction in contributions. The coal industry has seen a horrific drop in the amount of coal that we use in this country. There's 200 million tons of overcapacity in the United States as we sit here today. The second thing is we've seen a terrible drop in price. So those things working against each other has not caused a recession in coal fields, but it's called a depression, as Senator Manchin just mentioned. So coal companies, if asked to pay more, won't. And if they did, they'd be gone.
A number of us have been focused on this issue because of the impact it has on thousands of workers. Walk through what will happen, Mr. President, to PBGC if issues confronting, if this Congress fails, if the leadership in this Congress fails to act, what happens to PBGC?
It's been suggested we use some math here, so let me use some math. I never was too good at that, but let me give it a try. This came up a little bit earlier, but we have access to a letter that was written to Congressman McKinley. I don't know if that's been provided to the committee or not, where PBGC answered a question from Congressman McKinley about this issue. And PBGC said to a representative of the United States Congress, Congressman McKinley, that this would collapse PBGC in 2 to 3 years if indeed our fund went insolvent. So the question really in some ways here is whether or not the United States Congress wants PBGC to go insolvent along with our pension plan. And I think the answer to that in a bipartisan way is no, mainly because it costs more money using simple math here to fix this problem unless we just decide as a government that we'll just completely get out of the pension business, and that's not going to happen, in my opinion. There's one of three things that's going to happen here. First of all, Congress can fail to act and we can do nothing, and then the 1974 pension plan is going to go insolvent. The cost to the taxpayers of this country of insolvency is $4.6 billion. And I don't think that's a good way to approach this problem. The second thing is to take advantage of MPRA, which has been discussed here today, and the cost of that is $3 billion. If you pass this legislation that's been proposed in a very bipartisan way, the cost of the United States government is $2.2 billion, $1 billion cheaper than any other way to fix this problem. I must submit to the members of this committee that no matter where you come from on this issue, if you're very much concerned about the taxpayers' money, then you should pass this bill. If you're concerned about pensioners, you should pass this bill. If you're concerned about health care, you should pass this bill. Because every other way that's been suggested here is pretty bad, and it's more costly than any other way to fix this.
One thing that hasn't been talked about, Cecil, is how the funding can be used from the abandoned mine land fund to help fund the Miners Pension Protection Act, which I'm a co-sponsor of, and thank you for your work with our coal miners throughout Eastern Iowa. As you say, they're getting hit from all sides. Let's face it. You can call it a war on coal. You can call it a battle on coal. I don't care what you call it. You know, we're losing coal miners every single day, and the retirees are getting hit now because of the pension. So $495 million is what I see currently in mine land fund, and they've been spending less than half of that. Can you talk a little about that?
I think it'd be good to lay just a little foundation here, because the premise of this legislation is to draw from what is already there. This is another role that the government has played in these plans over the years. In 92, legislation was passed and signed by Republican President George Bush that allowed for any minor that retired prior to October 1st, 94 to have their health care guaranteed by the United States government off the interest money of the Band of Mind Fund. This law was amended in 2006. It also established a permanent appropriation of $400 and some million. And that theory behind that was that the coal industry was paying this amount of money in taxes on leasing. So there's two funding sources that have been available here since 92 to fund the health care and slash, to, and now we're proposing not to add anything else to that legislation other than to just give us a right to have access to the amount of money that was appropriated on a permanent basis in 2006. So we're not here without a solution to this. And that's the only thing that this legislation is asking to be done. So there's two sources of funding here, but the interest money off of the Band of Mines Fund, plus you make a good point, Senator, there is additional money in the Band of Mines Fund itself. It has not been used, but we have access, as we gather here today, to the interest money off of that. Plus, we have a permanent appropriations established by the Congress of the United States in 2006 for health care purposes. If we extended that to pension purposes, we could fix this problem. That's pretty much what this bill does.
Well, that's a really important point to make, and I thank you for letting us know that there is a solution out there that's, I think, very reasonable.
And one of the best ways to convey why we have to act is what this means to these miners and to their families. The benefits are rather modest. They average about $530 a month. And I guess, President Roberts, my one and only question in the interest of time is, you just tell us what this means to those miners and their families, how it will affect them if we don't act.
There are 90,000 people that we've talked about, one of which I never mentioned, happens to be my 96-year-old mother, who's a widow, and still receives a widow's pension from the United Mine Workers Fund. I know literally thousands of these people across this country who are depending on these pensions every month. They go to the mailbox or they go to the post office, and that helps them survive. So the effects on losing these pensions would be dramatic.
What is the drop-dead date when Congress needs to act, Mr. Roberts?
Probably tomorrow sometime, which we all know that's not going to happen. But let me paint this picture, if I might. If we don't act soon, the benefits of this legislation are not going to be as great as they would be if this law passes this year. If this goes down to a couple of years, the amount of funding provided for in this legislation may have a difficult time funding the 1974 plan, so we may not be able to avoid insolvency. The one thing I must stress to you, in addition to what I've just said, there's $1 billion a year that flows into the most depressed areas, most hard-hit areas of our economy in Appalachia from the health and retirement funds. If these plans collapse, then we'll lose another $1 billion. We've lost 25,000 jobs in the coal mining industry in the last 3 or 4 years. We've been dealing with bankruptcy after bankruptcy after bankruptcy. We've gotten fewer and fewer people paying into these plans, and more people are at risk of losing their health care as we come here today. I urge this committee to start this process of fixing this problem and passing this legislation on to their colleagues in the United States Senate. This is a desperate time for coal miners. I think the coal miners in this country have been promised these benefits. These coal miners in this country have earned these benefits. These coal miners in this country have sacrificed greatly to this nation so all of us can have a better way of life. And we urge consideration of this, and thank you.